Good morning. Welcome to worship at Cape Fear Presbyterian Church. We are so glad that you are with us this morning, and you are all welcome in this house of God. If you haven't already done so, please take the red fellowship pads, which are parked in the pew rack on the center aisle. If you would add your name to the page, add the date to that page if it's not there when it comes to you. Pass it on down the row. When it gets to the end, you can send it on back and then take a peek and see who's sitting in the pew with you. Perhaps learn the name of somebody new and be able to greet them personally at the conclusion of our worship service. You can leave those in the pads, and one of our deacons will collect those at the conclusion of the service. Wayne, can you turn this down just a little bit? Thank you. A few announcements for you. If you'll take out the announcements section of your bulletin, it's the colored insert. I'm going to highlight just a few things, and I want you to hang on to that Church World Service blankets dedication. We're going to do that right at the end of the announcement, so keep that close. Right after worship today, we're going to hold a congregational meeting. This is for members of Cape Fear Presbyterian Church. The purpose of the meeting is to elect elders and deacons. Information on those names and those individuals are in your bulletin, so if you'll just hang tight for a few minutes after worship, we'll get this done lickety-split. Coming up this week, our Presbyterian women's group, they meet in what we call circles. This happens the first Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday of the month. Since Tuesday is the 1st of March, hard to believe, right? 1st of March, Circle number 2 meets Tuesday morning at 10:30. Circle number 3 meets Wednesday morning at 10:30. Circle number 1 will meet the following week on Monday night. We'll put that in the bulletin for next week. So if you are, you don't have to be Presbyterian to participate in that. If you are interested in participating in their Bible study, which is, it's been a really good one on the topic of water as a theme for life, come to one of these circles. You're absolutely welcome. Anyone is welcome to come and participate in those meetings. Coming up next Sunday, we will gather around the table for the Sacrament of Communion. That will take place next Sunday during worship. Are there other announcements this morning? Yvonne? Great. Sunday, March 6th is a shower for Brittany and Kyle Holt, so make that correction in your bulletin. 2 to 4. Time is the same, just the date is different. Any other announcements? Would you please stand as you are able and let us dedicate our blankets? For the entire month of February, we have been participating in the Blankets Plus program. You all have purchased a blanket for $5 and placed a heart up here in honor or in memory of loved ones. You have practically filled this blanket, and that is a wonderful, wonderful thing. We'll be helping out so many people with blankets and other things that go with the Church World Service program. Let us dedicate our blankets using the litany found in your bulletin. There are parts for women and men, so pay attention to that. Gracious and loving God, we give thanks for the opportunity to care for those in need through Church World Service. As we make our offering, help us remember those whose daily struggle to survive would stagger us. Men and their families who are forced to flee from violence and war with nothing but the clothes on their back. Multiply what we have given, that they may build a better life. Let these gifts become blankets for the refugees, seeds for the struggling farmer, safe water for the young mother, mosquito nets for protecting children from disease, tools for the family rebuilding after an earthquake. Multiply our love through the Church World Service Blankets Plus program, that your will may be done this day and every day. Amen. Please remain standing and let us sing. Would you please join me in the call to worship as found in your bulletin? We live in the shelter of the Most High, in the shadow of God Almighty. The Lord will deliver us and protect us from our enemies. Because God watches over us, we have no reason to fear. God's angels stand guard around us, and God is always ready to help in times of trouble. As we prepare for our prayer of confession, take note that in the middle of the prayer, there is a period of silence, and then I will bring us back together to continue the rest of the prayer before we sing the Kyrie. Our God is ever more ready to listen than we are to pray. Let us bring our whole selves in this time of prayer, opening our hearts to God in honest acknowledgement of our shortcomings. Let us pray together. Great and loving God, forgive your church during these Lenten days. Forgive your church, its wealth among the hungry, its silence amidst the warfare, its cowardice among the oppressed. Forgive us, your children, our lack of confidence, our lack of faith, our lack of hope, our lack of love, our lack of courage in you. We continue with the prayer. Restore us to covenant with you and to feast in the love of our Lord Jesus Christ. Help us now during this Lenten season to renew our lives in your great spirit and to look forward to the hope and promise of new life given to us daily in Jesus Christ. Amen. My friends, know that God hears our prayers, which we say together and which we have lifted in the silence of this sanctuary of safety and love. Lent offers us a chance to begin again, knowing that God knows us through and through and loves us still. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen. Since God has forgiven us in Christ, let us forgive one another. May the grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with each and every one of you.
And also with you.
Turn to those around you and greet one another with signs and words of peace. That's pretty big. I heard about a guy this week who wears size 17, and he's like 17. Want to invite all the children to come forward. We've been chatting about shoe sizes. As I almost tripped coming down the steps because I love my large feet and the small steps. So we welcome you into that conversation. Good morning. How's everybody doing? What does it mean to be big? Speaking of shoes, speaking of large shoes, does it mean being physically large? Does it mean being strong? Is big always better? Yes, that is sort of the prevailing thought, but we're going to find out that that's not necessarily the case. So I brought some pictures of some sporting equipment, some sports balls with me today. Each one is for a different game. What's this one?
Ping pong.
Ping pong. What? Can you describe a ping pong ball for me?
It's hollow.
It's small, right? It's small. It's very lightweight, right? Yeah, it goes. They go pretty far, especially if you hit it quite right. All right, so then how about this one?
Golf ball.
Golf ball is it's still a small ball, relatively speaking. It's a little heavier than a ping pong ball. It can go far. That's absolutely right. Could you play a better game of ping pong with a golf ball?
No.
You've tried. Christian's tried. All right, so moving up, this one's a little bit larger. What is this?
Softball.
Yeah, softball's heavier than a golf ball and a ping pong ball, right? All right, and then finally, basketball, still bigger still. This is the largest ball that I brought a picture with this morning. Can you play Could you play golf with a softball?
No.
Could you play ping pong or golf or softball with a basketball? You've tried. Good experimentation. I like that. All right. So when being bigger is not always better. It depends on the game that you're trying to play. You can't play basketball with a ping pong ball, but neither can you play ping pong with a basketball. We talk about the Apostle Paul a lot. He was a follower of Jesus Christ. He wrote a series of letters in the Bible to churches that were just starting out, including one in a town called Corinth. When Paul was writing to a friend in Corinth, he suggested that they have big hearts. What do you think he meant? Does it mean that the heart is beating in your chest so much that it's really, really big? Probably not. It means that when you do really good things for others, you have a big heart. And big hearts are found in people of all sizes. Wonderful things are possible when you have a big heart. You can take care of your world instead of using it up. You can play fair even when you could get away without being fair. You can give something of yours to a friend or to someone you don't even know just because he or she needs it. This morning, we're going to kick off our one great hour of sharing. We do this every year, right around this time. We're going to use these banks to save up money for people that we don't even know. We're going to collect change in these boxes. You're welcome to take one. Adults, welcome to take them as well. There'll be some at each door. Use it at home. Put it on your table. Add spare change. If you get some spare change from something, could be a penny, a dime, quarter, nickel, anything like that. And then I want you to bring this back on March 27th. That's Easter Sunday. That's about a month away from now. So I know that we can demonstrate our large hearts in this next month by filling up these banks. I learned this year for the first time. Who says you can't learn something new? These fish have names. It's actually, the name is Gracie. That's the name of the fish, Gracie. So you guys can name the fish anything you wanted to, but we call them Gracie in the Presbyterian Church. So you may not have a lot of money to give, but we're just looking for change. Your parents may only have a few dollars. But what this is so great, why this is so great, is that when we put all of our coins and our dollars and everything together, it makes a really big offering. And that we can use to help people around the world. Jesus doesn't ask us to be bigger than we are, but Jesus does ask us to open our hearts no matter what our size. Remember that you are always big enough to share and to give. That's what Jesus asks us to do, and that's what we can do if we try. Let's pray. Oh God, help us to have big hearts no matter what our size, so that we can help take care of our world, do what is fair and right, and give to others who need our help. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. For adults and kids as well, we've got these sharing calendars. They're out at the doors as well. This is just a really neat thing to do in terms of sort of working your way through the month. There are some scripture verses. There are some things to think about in terms of where this money goes. So grab one of these on your way out the doors this morning as well, and grab a bank. Thank you, boys and girls. Thank you. first scripture reading this morning is Psalm 27. We'll be reading this responsively, which means I'll read the odd-numbered verses, and I invite you to respond with the even-numbered verses. It can be found in the Bible using the page numbers that are listed in your bulletin. It may be a little like Groundhog Day this week, because you did go through these verses last Sunday. Thanks to Marge for filling in and doing all the liturgy and other things. And Carolyn, you did the prayer, I heard. So thank you all very much. Nancy, you know, it's rare that I have to miss a Sunday morning because I woke up not feeling well. But it is so gratifying to know that things can just keep going. And so thanks to all who jumped in to lead worship last week. And since you guys have already been through these verses, you probably could preach the sermon. Let's do Psalm 27. I'll read the odd-numbered verses, and I invite you to respond with the even-numbered verses. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? Though an army encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war rise up against me, yet I will be confident. For he will hide me in his shelter in the day of trouble. He will conceal me under the cover of his tent. He will set me high on a rock. Hear, O Lord, when I cry aloud. Be gracious to me and answer me. Do not hide your face from me. Do not turn your servant away in anger, you who have been my help. Do not cast me off. Do not forsake me, O God of my salvation. Teach me your way, O Lord, and lead me on a level path because of my enemies. I believe that I shall see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Once upon a time, the Lord said to Abram, "Go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you. I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse those who curse you. And in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed." As far as promises go, you can't find one any more solid than this. When God promises to bless you and make your name great, well, you can take that to the bank. On a human level, in this day and age, promises don't seem to mean as much anymore. They don't carry the clout that they once did. There was a time when someone could seal a deal with a handshake and the phrase, "My word is my bond." It's like saying that people can trust you because if you promise to do something, you will. But nowadays, there are so many empty, hollow promises. Exhibit A, the world of politics, especially in a political or a presidential election cycle. Candidates from both parties are throwing around campaign pledges, each more outlandish than the next. "Vote for me. I'll make everything perfect for everybody." Abram wasn't running for political office. There were no caucuses or primaries. He was appointed by God as a prophet to the people. Not to mention that God's pact with him was no ordinary pledge, but rather a covenant. A covenant is, in effect, a promissory oath in which one party, in this case God, promises to do something in the future for the other party, Abram. So Abram's a prophet appointed by God who has promised him great things. You've heard me talk about prophets before. A primary role of the prophet was to be the voice of God for and to the people of God. Sounds easy enough, right? With God on your side, what could go wrong? Surely God would pave the way for you. Surely God's people will listen to you. But the life of the prophet was usually a difficult one. They endured great hardships in the service of the Lord. And no, God's people do not always listen. Such was the case for Abram, later known as Abraham, and his wife Sarai, later known as Sarah, an elderly couple who had no children. A great deal happened to them in the ensuing years between this auspicious beginning, the verses that I read from Genesis 12, and our focus passage for this morning. So much so that Abram's trust in God is waning. By way of a very brief synopsis, here's what Abram and Sarai have been up to since they embarked on this journey, leaving their homeland in Mesopotamia to go to the promised land in Canaan. Abram and Sarai eventually make their way to Canaan after a side trip in Egypt, where they have a tense encounter with Pharaoh that not only threatens their marriage, but their very lives. Next is a quarrel within the extended family, which results in a separation between Abram and his nephew Lot, after which Abram is drawn into a bloody conflict involving major principalities of southern Palestine. Whew, that's a lot in the short period of about 10 years. It's worth noting that when Abram set out on this journey, he was about 75. So that makes him now about 85. Sarai is 10 years younger than her husband, still no children. But a promise is a promise, a covenant is a covenant, and so Abram and Sarai endure. Along the way, God offers encouragement to Abram with words such as these from chapter 13. Raise your eyes now and look from the place where you are, northward and southward, eastward and westward. For all the land that you see, I will give to you and your offspring forever. As we arrive at our text for this morning, beginning at chapter 15, verse 1, we find God making another declaration to Abram. Do not be afraid. I am your shield. Your reward shall be very great. Up until this point, the biblical picture of God and Abram's relationship is fairly straightforward. God speaks, Abram listens. God promises, Abram believes. God commands, Abram obeys. However, there comes a point, and it's right here in our text, verse 2, when Abram finally says, wait a minute, I've got a question for you. What use are your gifts if I'm childless? Abram had reached a breaking point. Given his and his wife's advanced ages, it's likely they had all given up having children years ago. But then when God starts talking and mentioning things like, I'll make of you a great nation and offspring, well, they probably started warming up to the idea. They trusted God's leading in this area like they trusted it in every other facet of their life. But now 10 more years have gone by since God called. And you can imagine Abram, not to mention Sarai, growing more than a little anxious about this whole childbearing thing. So now he's more than a little frustrated with God. I can imagine the conversation went like this. God, I don't mean to question you, but your whole legacy plan, this nation-building thing, is going to come to a screeching halt if we don't have a child to inhabit and inherit your land. We're tired. As you know, we're older. We've been through a lot. Where is this child you keep promising? As Abram's questions start to surface, they also start to sound like complaints. God's response? Don't worry. Then from the scripture we read that God took Abram by the hand and led him outside and said, look at the sky. Count the stars. Can you? Count your descendants. You're going to have a very big family. What a marvelous illustration. We're fortunate to live where we do, to be able to see plenty of stars in the sky. It's possible because unlike larger cities, we have very little light pollution. Light pollution is the effect of so many streetlights, lighted signs, etc., that hinder the view of the night sky. Now, imagine the kind of view you would have when you get away from the city, out into the country. It's as if someone flipped on a light switch of 1,000 more stars. Now imagine you live back in the day of Abram and Sarai, where there were no lights whatsoever. The view would be simply amazing. And God essentially says to Abram, the number of your descendants will be as vast as the stars. Abram gets it. His response to God, I believe you. What does it take for us to believe? What does it take for us to trust God in the big and small details of our lives? We like to think of ourselves as being people who inherently trust God. Yet theologian H. Richard Niebuhr repeatedly maintained that the first response of humanity toward God is that of distrust. Although God is good to us, we do not trust God. Perhaps we're suspicious of God's great generosity and that we're somehow unworthy of it. Abram, too, had difficulty believing and accepting that he might be blessed beyond measure. But God did not give up. He kept finding new ways to demonstrate his love and care for Abram and reinforcing his covenant promises. When we encounter life's challenges, when we feel the anxiety of doubt and uncertainty, when we struggle with frustration and disappointment, recall the story of Abram. And lean in to God. Open your heart to the Lord and trust that He has a purpose and a plan for you and that you will be blessed. In a book titled Sabbatical Journeys, Pastor Henry Nouwen wrote about the special relationship that trapeze artists have with one another when they're performing. Excuse me. He had some friends known as the Flying Rudellas, and they described to him what goes on between the flyer and the catcher. They told Nouwen that the flyer is the one who lets go, and the catcher, obviously, is the one that catches the flyer. As the flyer swings out high above the crowd on the trapeze, the moment comes when he must let go. He arcs out into the air. His job is to remain as still as possible and wait for the strong hands of the catcher to pluck him out of the air. One of the Rudellas told Nouwen, "The flyer must never try to catch the catcher. The flyer must wait in absolute trust. The catcher will catch him. But for the catcher to be able to do that, the flyer must let go and completely trust that he will be caught." Friends, as we journey through this season of Lent and beyond, understand that faith is a matter of trust. And unlike so many of the empty promises in this world, we can trust God's assurances. God desires good for you. So let go and trust God's faithfulness. Amen. As you are able, would you please stand? And let us say what it is we believe by using the words of the Apostles' Creed as found in your bulletin. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day He rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence He shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Let us sing together hymn number 333.
Now is the time of our service when we share our prayers with others in our church family. Prayers of concern, prayers of joy. What is on your mind today? Who do we need to be praying for? Let me turn on my phone.
There we go. What's the last name? Okay, prayers for the Miller family. Okay. Susan Scarf's sister, Lindsay Davis, is having some health issues. We will keep her in our prayers. Yes. Prayers for God. He would be very happy for us to be praying for God. Yes. He's got a big job. A few names in the bulletin I want to highlight for you. Annie Merle Piner, she had spent some time in the hospital this month. She is now at Liberty Commons, which is on Racine Drive. If you would like to visit with her, if you'd like the room number, come see me after worship. Doris Gore is still at, I believe still at Wilmington Health and Rehab on Wellington. And we've had, Betty Matthews. Betty Matthews was recovering from emergency hernia surgery, which took place last Monday. She was supposed to go home on Friday, so that is good news, and we rejoice in that. So if you know the Matthews, Betty and Lawrence are former members of our congregation. I'm sure they'd appreciate a call or a card. So a lot of folks are still sick with colds and flu and various things. Several of us were out last week, as we talked about. I noticed there's lots of folks out this week, too, children and adults. So continue to pray for all those who are experiencing the effects of colds and flu and everything else. Others? Tyson? Okay. Is that what you're praying about, that you're not friends with Tyson? Okay. Just for Tyson. Okay. We'll pray for Tyson. Yes. Good. Thank you. Darcy.
A general prayer that
Yeah. General prayers for those who are having difficulty in their marriage, people who are going through separations and maybe divorces, unfortunately. And lift up those who are in need of that. Family of Tony Spadafora, who recently passed away. Thank you, Alice.
Prayers for Kristen Lee.
Okay. Prayers for Kristen Lee. Let's take these to God. God of grace and love, God of healing, God of presence, God of trust, God of faithfulness. We come to you with thanksgiving for who you are, for how you are revealed through your Son, Jesus Christ, and your Holy Spirit. Lord, help us to remember to trust you when things get difficult. That's not always our first reaction. We often try to sort things out on our own. We try to figure out how we can manage a situation, how we can take care of it, how if we do this outcome, then the other will be that outcome. Remind us to put you first, to go to you first. Let you be our first prayer and our first thought. Even though we may not see how all these pieces are going to fit together, help us to trust you that they will. You are so much bigger than us, so much bigger than our imaginations and our thoughts. We try to sometimes put you in a little tiny box, thinking we've got you all figured out. Remind us of how silly that is. You are magnificent. You are abundant. You are faithful. Help us to trust that always. We trust you, Lord, with the names that we have mentioned here this morning, those people who are in need. You know the needs even before we do. Prayers of healing, prayers of restoration, prayers of reconciliation. You know the prayers that are on our hearts in addition to those that have been said aloud. Help us to trust you with the outcome. Remove the burden from us, Lord. Take care. We thank you for this church. We thank you for all of those gathered here this morning. They've made coming here to worship a priority, to be in your presence. We thank you for this congregation, for this church, for its years of ministry and service. Help us to continue to be the hands and feet of your Son, Jesus Christ, always putting others' needs before our own. We are grateful for your blessings, Lord. Lord, there is so much going on in the world every day, new headlines that disturb us. Sometimes we get so overwhelmed, we don't know how to begin even praying, but then your Spirit intercedes and shows us how to pray. Help us to lean on your Holy Spirit in guiding our prayers daily. Again, Lord, we just thank you and praise you. You are far more abundant than anything that we can possibly dream or imagine. Let us close by saying the prayer together which Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. One of the ways in which we thank God for God's blessings is through the giving of our tithes and offerings. Would the ushers please come forward? Most gracious and holy God, we do give you thanks for these gifts and the givers, and we dedicate them to your use, both here in Wilmington and throughout the world. Let all of God's people together say, Amen. Reminder that we will hold a brief congregational meeting in just a few moments. Let me pronounce the benediction. Friends, our worship ends, but now our work begins. May the amazing grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the extravagant love of God, and the ever-present fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all this day and always. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.